I think we met long before you were planning
really?
The show, because at least that's in my memory, because it was and anyway, it's a delight to be here, and it's a delight to have Amelia introduce me. And as an editor, we were proud to publish her writings in Meaning, which is why I think it goes back before that. Yes, and I'm in LA because I have an exhibition at CB1 Gallery, and there's concurrently an exhibition by Tom Nechtel, who is a friend since my days at CalArts, which is where I got my graduate degree. So let's hope I can get through this, because this is the end of a long week in LA and a long day, so I'm kind of pooped. And every time I give a talk, I adapt the talk to what interests me right now. I'm not an artist that has a talk and then I give it wherever wherever I am. So sometimes the talks are short. I've learned how to do talks with just 10 slides or whatever. But in some way, in keeping with the nature of the work that I'm showing, and partly in keeping in the title that I came up with Amelia's prodding, I've ended up with a talk with a lot of slides. But I will try to go through them fast, and you can kind of. So actually, I should.
You want the lights off?
I can have the lights off, and we'll for the moment we'll keep that up. So, in thinking about the title, I think both of us. I don't know, I can't remember who thought of what, but anyway, I thought it was important to basically include both of my practices. I have to say that I think I do have a blog called A Year of Positive Thinking, which I started after I finished the manuscript for A Decade of Negative Thinking. So I think I might, occasionally I'll post a discussion that I've had on Facebook as a text on, it sort of seems a little lazy, but occasionally there'll be really interesting discussions. And we just had our first week of school about 10 days ago. And we start at Parsons, in the graduate program, we start with a slide slam. So all the new students and all the second year students have 5 minutes to show their work each. It takes the whole afternoon. And especially, of course, the first year students are very nervous. Everybody's very nervous, in fact. And but it's fun. And so I'm sitting next to one of my colleagues, and one student says, "My practice," and I turned around and I said, "I just think we have got to do something about that word, because if you've only been an artist for a year, you do not have a practice." And also, but in fact, then I realized that I had, in fact, hosted an interesting discussion about that about a year ago. So I get on Facebook, I Google Mira Shore practice, and sure enough, up it pops. And I had done this the day after last year's first day of school, when of course all the students were saying, "My practice." But in fact, I do have a practice, because I've been an artist for, depending on how you count it, 44 years or so. Plus I am a painter and a writer, so I think that kind of qualifies for. So the choice of the title, though, indicates a duality of work and a duality, I think, of temperament. And so this talk is going to circulate around those dualities. And this afternoon, I thought it's interesting. In the morning, I couldn't remember the word dichotomy. It just didn't come, it's like on the tip of my tongue, but it didn't come. And I thought, well, actually, the thing is that in a way, duality is more comprehensive of being both, not being one or the other, even though they're, a binary might be another word that would be critical of being dual in some sense. But as you will see, body and mind, painting, writing, there are many dualities that come up in the talk. And one of them also is that the show is really two shows with two bodies of work, one done in the 90s and one done this summer. So my talk is partly long because I want to talk about both of these. And even though there are a lot of images, some of them are kind of going to proceed in a cinematic manner, so it will go fairly fast. I hope. So I'm going to start out with a few works at that, and I'm not going to look because I know that they're a little blurry in this projection, so it's always a good idea not to see what's going on up there. These are just sort of place setters that give you some idea of some of my goals, some of the themes, and you'll see some other things. So the first thing you're seeing is a work that I did my second year as a graduate student at CalArts. It's called The Two Mirrors. It's a gouache on Arches paper, 22 by 30. And I had been in the feminist art program the first year. I was one of the participants in the Woman House project. Then I left to pursue, you know, to be in the school in a more general way and to bring, you know, some of the feminist ideas into the school as a whole. And this work was part of, let's say, the first group of works where I was attempting to do something that by the time I left graduate school I described as my agenda, except I didn't have an agenda. So the word agenda, by which I mean, in 1973 I didn't use the word agenda, but the rest of it was there, which was that I wanted to bring into high art in as intact a form as possible the experience of living inside a female body with a mind. And what I think now is that almost every one of those terms has been problematized since then. So female body is problematized, high art is problematized. But the one thing that was really prescient is that I emphasized mind. And by doing that, for one thing, I opened up a lifetime of art making as opposed to just art making as a young woman. And it's been able to take me through a lot of transformations. So when my first instinct, based on my history and my earlier work as a, you know, my juvenilia, which I actually find quite interesting, you could consider this my juvenilia as well. My first instinct was to have my own body in the work. So in other words, I was represented by a self-portrait. And I did these works when I began the direction of these works before I knew about artists like Frida Kahlo or Florian Stettheimer. So when I discovered them, I was discovering sisters rather than influences, but of course they were very encouraging. So here you have the two mirrors. If my friend Tom Nechtel were here, which he wasn't able to come, he remembers that I called it that this was based on a dream. I don't remember that at all. But I think one can, at this point, I feel like I'm interpreting it as much as anybody else, whatever that, you know, who those two women were. Clearly, one is calm and one is emotional. And I feel like that certainly is, I tend to think of myself as a more Apollonian person, which will come across, I mean, as an artist. But there is a very emotional side as well, so perhaps that was it. I did this in California. I loved California landscape. Landscape has been an important source of form, even when the form turns out to be something like the penis. I may have actually been looking at a redwood tree. So so here's another duality. Actually, here's two dualities within the same work. This is a much more recent work. It's a painting where you see a figure reading under a tree, the leaf of the trees. At the top is theory. It's a very bleached out atmosphere. And then under the grass, in the thonic area of the underground, is another figure. And that figure is involved with visual pleasure and is in a more warm and, you know, green and warm environment. So presumably you can never see both at the same time in the reality of the work. Either it's one or the other. But so in exhibition we've taken to sometimes, like, the gallery will occasionally move it, like, you know, you might move the chair or something. Thanks to the wonders of Photoshop, you get a little bit of an opportunity of the ability to see both. So reversibility, technically, literally, of a painting that is reversible or a piece of paper which is worked from front to back is very characteristic of my work. So it's a duality. I'll show you something in a minute that will point to what the source, one of the sources of that might be. Amelia mentioned my magazine Meaning, which I co-founded with another painter, Susan B., in 1986. So up until, from the time I graduated from graduate school to the early 80s, I was a painter, and I called myself a painter even though I didn't necessarily actually create paintings a lot of that time. I worked with paper, I made sculptures out of paper, but my identity has always been painter. But something made me start to write about art. I always knew I could write, but I needed some. There had to be a motivating factor which woke me up. And so in the early 80s, which I probably will talk about more than once, there was a dramatic transformation in the late 70s. 79 was the turning point. There was a dramatic transformation visible in culture and in art culture. So, there was a transformation from a kind of sincerity about materiality and process and an ironic relationship to culture and the entrance of appropriation art. And also there was a transformation of art language in publications like Art Forum, and notably through the increasing influence of October magazine, of a straightforward, more descriptive or natural language, spoken language type of art writing, even including Smithson and Barnett Newman, Alan Caprow, all the artists, I'm naming all artists who were writers, as well as John Berger and so forth, to language which was altered by the insertion of the vocabulary of all kinds of critical theory. So, and there was a tremendous focus on the part of October against painting, and in the interest of photography and other forms of photo-based work. The upshot of this was that I ended up wanting to write an article about David Sally's representation of women. He was somebody that I went to graduate school with, or to school with. I was actually on his graduate admissions committee. And I could not get it published. And significantly, I did know people at October, so I did submit it, and they did write a letter, which I hope is where I hope it is somewhere in storage, because it was really a very important letter, where they said, well, you know, we don't like him either, but the problem is not what he's painting, it's that he's painting. And so that's, for that and other personal, public personal reasons, I was very connected to, like, October was my opponent, and it was not so much my opponent as my other challenge, where I learned, but also I was writing to them. They had never acknowledged that I exist or have ever put a piece of paper and pen together. But we began Meaning. We did it twice. We published it twice a year for 10 years. And the next image, this was my entrance onto a public stage. Going from the privacy of the studio and really anonymity, although I was born into the art world and we were in this, both of us were sort of in the art world, but nevertheless, you know, we were just like two young artists who didn't have galleries and had the great freedom and the blessing of anonymity in a way, so there was nothing to lose in doing this. But we created a public space. We created a little space. It's amazing how you can create real estate for yourself. And then we had an online iteration. Then we did the anthology in 2000 from Duke University Press. And then in 2011, did a online 25th anniversary issue. So if Meaning, which we chose as what was the most repressed at that moment, in 1986. And we felt like an unironic relationship to meaning was the thing that was the most repressed. However, we did put in the slashes, so that kind of interrupted, broke up, and problematized the word. But what would be the current repressed? And so I created this image. It's not actually an actual cover of anything. I just like my triumph of photoshopping something. I created this image for the text that I wrote for this forum that we did online. So you could go to it. If you go to just Google meaning, and you'll find it. And I thought that in a way privacy now was the thing that was the most problematic, the most repressed, you know, living in a world of social media, of all kinds of information tracking, Patriot Act, etc. So, and we did this 25th anniversary issue. It came out in the late fall of 2011 online. So in the immediate aftermath of Occupy Wall Street. In fact, Susan B. went to China during Occupy Wall Street, and while she was away, I remember standing at the corner on the street and just writing, saying, while you were gone, something has completely transformed culture, and we have got to address that in our anniversary issue. So so that's the other side of privacy, which I didn't reread my piece. I don't remember exactly what I wrote, but I know that I'm complete addict of the internet, and that I'm on Facebook all the time, and I'm a social media junkie of sorts. But in order to create work, I demand, first of all, to live as a human being, I demand a lot of privacy, and in order to create artwork, I need total privacy. So, so meanwhile, you're looking at a page here, a sort of page shape, 8.5 by 11 type of size. So now I'm going to switch back to a major work that I did in 1976 called Book of Pages. And there are many things about this book that make it a kind of artwork for me, just as much as maybe the two mirrors was, but this perhaps even more. First of all, you see now I no longer need to be there as a figure. I am represented by language. And that was very, very important to me, because in my 20s, I began to sort of see that women are filled with language, but they're not perceived by the world as being filled with language, as thought, intellectual process. And that was very much something that I wanted to work with. The language in Book of Pages is personal. It was all aimed basically at one person, like a giant love letter. I also wanted to make a large work that was not a large work, but that proceeded through accumulation of layers. Very much like one of the works that I'm showing that's up at CB1, the piece War Freeze, which I'll talk about in greater detail. It was a major modular piece that began, it had an organic growth, and then it came to an end, but it's not like there was an ending that was planned. It's not like when you start to write a mystery story and you already know who did it. As the author, the size of, and also it's paper, and it's rice paper, which is translucent. So if you see my show of new work at CB1, you'll see that, and you'll see in the pictures, it's tracing paper and it's translucent. So there's a connection there too. And the other thing is that there's, in the next image is a little better, the page itself, the module was about 9 by 12. Oops, I don't know why it does that, it did that before. 9 by 12, if you open it up, it's about 12 by 17 or 18, which is pretty much the module of oil painting that I worked on for many, many years, 12 by 16. So there's so many things that made this work resonate through time. However, in keeping with the duality of public-private, this is an intensely, by necessity, private work in that it's extremely fragile, very hard to exhibit because you can only have one page open at a time. It has to be in a vitrine. So in fact, its public existence is through representation. I have this, and this is a drawing I did when I was 9. And as you can see, I'm reading a book. The book is drawn exactly the way I draw books now. There's absolutely no difference. And I'm very happily, I have fruit, and I have some beverage. I love Greek mythology, and this was somewhat based on whatever it was I was reading. And I think that that floating figure is actually a patriarchal figure, like a philosopher, like a Greek philosopher or something like that. But I can't interview myself at age. So then I'm going to switch the last of these sort of introduction. Is a little bit about sort of how I try to work in recent times. So now I'm lying under a tree in my house, in my garden in Provincetown, just like I did in the picture when I was 9. I try to read books from beginning to end during the summer. That's my big treat. I have to find a book I want to read that resonates with me, so it's always hit or miss. I have a few notebooks next to me where I do what I call parallel writing, so I'm reading, but then I may have a thought about something else I was thinking about, and then I also may make notes. I write in the margins of the book, and also I have sketchbooks. So the sketchbook may reflect some of the themes or words in the book. So the theme of voice and speech, or in this case, speech and noise, which I extrapolated from Michel de Certeau's The Practice of Everyday Life, which is the book I was reading. And then I go and do a painting of that. So this is a painting about this big, oil painting, although it looks very graphic, in which you have the terms of the thought process influenced by the book. So in particular, speech and voice, which is a dichotomy that de Certeau picks up. So speech is the knowledge that preceded the Enlightenment. It's an embodied knowledge, or it's a practicum knowledge of the intelligence of craft. Voice is the public speech of theory and education. And then you have silence and noise. And then you have matter, like a sack of matter. And then the roots of that are visual pleasure. And this is actually a very painterly painting, except it's white, the major color is white.
Is that on board? Or?
No, it's not. It's oil on linen. In the 80s, I switched over from working on paper as my own main medium to working oil on canvas and then on linen.
How far is it coming off your wall?
These are 1.5 inches. This one, the earlier ones were closer to the wall, and the one in the war frieze is a narrow canvas frame. So the last sort of introduction to the introduction is something that shows you the roots of who I am as a person, as an artist. I think that I feel like a lot of people are becoming artists now, and I'm saying this in school, and I certainly think of my own students. People become artists without very much background in art, and that's always perhaps been the case. I mean, but it happens that I'm the daughter of two artists, and a number of my friends, my parents' friends were artists, and then they had daughters who also are artists, who are the daughters of artists. So we carry these traditions. And my parents, Resha and Ilyushor, were, I think, rather unusual artists. So first of all, art is something I've done all my life. I've been surrounded by all my life. But the kind of art that they made also marked me and made me the person who would decide to name a magazine meaning. This is their studio in New York. I've kept it as it is because it's a very narrow workshop room, very, very narrow space, filled with some tools. Some of them are quite old, some of which my father worked with. And one of them is this object, which I actually remember him working with. This is another, here, just take a look at the top because I'll describe what happens. This is another view of it. It's lead, so it's extremely heavy, and the orb swivels on the bottom, and then you stick, and you know, you see this sort of handle sticking out there. And so what you do is you, if you want to engrave a piece of silver, obviously you can't like be holding on to the silver with one hand and then trying to engrave with the other. So you heat the tar that's on this piece of wood, that's on this lead heavy base, and then you stick the metal in it, and then you can engrave with this. And my father had incredibly steady hands. He was trained as a jeweler, as a goldsmith and engraver in Eastern Europe in the early 20s as a teenager. So he had a kind of medieval guild training. And then he went to art school. So, and he was also came from a Hasidic Jewish tradition. So okay, so there's that. And I thought that this object in itself contains something that I would, that I always wish for, especially since I've been working in oil. I want to make a small work that has the density and weight of petrified wood, or in this case, lead, something that would be incredibly dense and intense, however small it might be. But also the craft that they had, what you're looking at are two mezuzahs. The one on the on your left is by my mother. It's about this big. And the one on the right is by my father. So you can see they're silver. You can see the engraving. So you get a little bit of the sense. I just chose one piece of his. And in his case, you see the sacrifice of Isaac. You open the door. Inside the door, there's a painted illumination. And the mezuzah is a talismanic object of Jewish practice. It's placed, traditionally it's placed on the door. You kiss it when you come in. It has a text inside it. And so I always think, which you never see, although my mother then outed that text when she began to do in a lot of other pieces. But I always think, I was brought up in a home where the object that was, one of the objects that was made that actually supported us were one of a kind, handmade, artworks in which text was secreted. Mm-hmm. Now that, so that's where I come from. So my parents' work made it impossible for me to be part of my cohort completely. When I tried to think about why was I not like David Sally or Eric Fischel or Matt Mullican or whatever, I can be ironic about politics. I can play ironically with language, but I cannot be ironic about art practice. And so that separated me, perhaps fatally, from my cohort. I wanted to put in a work by my mother because it picks up on the theme of duality and reversibility. So this is one piece. It's a heavy silver and gold with precious and semi-precious stones. And the back is, you know, as incredible looking as the front. And she did it just before the backside of the moon was photographed in the 60s. And the way, so that part is actually instrumental to creating the front part. And that's very typical of my work, that often I'll work on the back in order to create the front, but then the back, which was done unintentionally or but instrumentally, ends up being more interesting. So there are a lot of drawings, which I won't necessarily show you. So this is a very long introduction. You'll see like my beautiful parents and both of them working, but with about five decades actually, between those pictures. Okay, so now we're getting close to Mira's work. So the first image that I thought of, to follow up on this idea about, you know, why I don't feel that I'm exactly part of my cohort, but relating to the first work I'm going to present that's in my show, Warfreeze, which is based on appropriated language. I thought I'd show a painting which is a drawing. It's ink on gesso on linen. And it brings together a number of words to create a potential third word. So you have appropriated, inappropriate, inappropriately, inappropriatedly. So even when I worked with appropriation, I still wasn't working appropriately with appropriation because I was just interested in something different in the culture. But I was appropriating language from the news. And so Warfreeze is a piece that I decided to do in the immediate aftermath of the first Gulf War, which happened in a 3-week period in the early winter of 1991. And I decided to do a piece about that would be an endless painting. This was the image I had, an endless painting that would be about endlessly circular militarism and aggression. And I began it, and very much like Book of Pages, first of all, it was modular because I worked on this module of 12 by 16. And also, there was no end in sight. And the war was over, so I'm like, that was like bad timing. But in thinking about like why did that particular incident make me want to do an artwork? Why that war? I was brought up during the Vietnam War. So what was it about that war? And I think that what I've come to the conclusion, first of all, it was an absurd war where there was no particular point and it didn't end in a way that made any sense. But the most important thing about it that distinguished it from the Vietnam War was its visuality, the visual language of it. So the Vietnam War was, you saw it every night on television, but what you saw was footage filmed on the ground of both reporters, Vietnamese and Americans, slogging it through the mud, suffering. Everybody was suffering. What you saw in the Gulf War was the camera was on the nose of a bomb, and it was showing you the target, and then it was hitting the target. That was the innovation of that war. In the spring of 91, there was a big parade, and I don't know what it was actually called, but I called it the War Parade. It may have been called the Patriotism Day or something like that. And it took place in Lower Manhattan, where I lived, and they parked jet fighter planes and missile launchers with the missiles on them, of course, I'm sure not loaded, on my street. So this is my street, Lispinard Street. And this is my house, 60 Lispinard, with this plane with folded wings parked. So I had already started War Freeze, and so War Freeze developed in kind of short sentence parts, basically, that were where the language was appropriated from the news or from the name of a weapon. It developed, the sections got longer, the way it's painted got changed over time. And so what you're seeing in this picture are the top two strips that were installed in a studio that I had in 92, 93. And both these sections are at the gallery, so we'll see them again in another iteration. This is really hard to see, but one of the images was that basically, it was about the way in which patriarchy extends itself through endless surrogates. So I'll just read it for you. Basically, there's like this penis out of which comes the word dada on two canvases. So it's both daddy and dada. And then that bleeds into a condom. Then that turns into another phallus, which is holding an American flag, but instead of the stars and stripes, there's a penis, and that bleeds into a blood-filled toilet, which I associated with femininity. So this is an earlier part of War Freeze, which is not on view. Another early part was inspired by the Anita Hill testimony at the Clarence Thomas hearings, where I actually swallowed a fishbone wrong the night of that testimony and had to go to the hospital the next day because I was basically going like this because I couldn't believe that people were talking about pubic hair on the public air in Congress. So I'll sort of spell this out. So you have this sort of thread of blood, and I wanted it to look like, if you were about 6 feet from the painting, that it would look like pubic hair had somehow fallen onto the canvas. And then you have the mixture of pubic and public. And I would just stop to say that at that point, this is sort of language as still life object. So at that time, in any self-respecting book on feminists, theory, every word was deconstructed into some other potential meaning or reading. So you have the L in the parentheses, and then you have hair and air, and then they go down a blood-filled toilet. And the blood-filled toilet made me very happy because I felt that I had answered in painting the most fetishized artwork of the 20th century, namely Duchamp's urine. And in painting and in a gendered way. Not that anybody's ever recognized that. But I'm still around to say it. So for a long time, Warfreeze existed in a little roll that I created of just some color Xeroxes cut out and strung together. So I could say, oh, it would look like this, you know. So I unrolled it just before I left, and just to sort of look at it. This is all the early part. And in fact, the show here begins with that last section, Undo. And then we unfurled it in the gallery. This is a panoramic shot of the piece. It's just beautifully installed. So I had not seen it. First of all, not only maybe 25 feet of it was shown in a show that Amelia curated at UC Riverside called Feminist Directions in the late 90s, was it? And the work has basically been in storage since. And I showed a small section on you. At my first show at CB1, and otherwise it's just been in storage. So one of the things was, I hadn't seen this work in a really long time, and there was always the chance that it wasn't a good painting, and that I just buffed it up in my mind as something that was important. So it's just been incredibly moving to be able to show, we've been able to show the second half of Warfreeze, so there's still the chance to show the whole thing sometime. I'm just going to run through it, try to pick up on certain details. These are just my little, you know, iPhone camera, so it's not the greatest resolution. So undue burden was wording of, you know, Supreme Court decision about abortion penned by Sandra Day O'Connor, that you could restrict abortion so long as you did not impose an undue burden on the woman. So that's, of course, open to interpretation. What is undue? And so burden is the red is in red. It's even in the room. It's hard to see it, but it's actually, if you touch it, you could read it because it's embossed in the way that I wrote it. So where we turned the corners, where we ended up having to do gaps because of the length of the wall, turned out to be really great. I love the corners, probably the best thing. So this particular connection. Now, Warfreeze is not just about the war in the first Gulf War or about war. It's really about a number of wars. So it's the war, the Gulf War. It's a war against women, and it's a war against painting. So it's my war with those people who were insistent on the fact that you could not do self-respecting political and intellectual art in painting. And I felt that this work did do that. So that was the part where I couldn't be, you know, obviously I'm biased, but I think it does it. I'm a tough critic also of myself at the same time. The gap is one of the things that interested me the most. So the way in which it's inappropriatedly is that there's no particular, it's not, I'm not appropriating, I mean, I'm appropriating an image, which is like one of the world's, you know, first images in since prehistory, but at the same time, I'm not appropriating another artist. I'm only appropriating language. And so that, but the rest of it is invented in some sense. It's my own invention, and decisions, and I think that also, you know, didn't make it a typical appropriated work. So there's an interesting gap between undue burden, which ends at the black on white image. And then the next one that picks up was based on the Clinton. So this is like, we're just, Clinton is, it's either just before the election or just after the first Bill Clinton election. It's the economy, stupid. And there was a comma in that. So It's the economy, comma, stupid. And I've been, in the 80s, I tried to teach myself new feminist theory, in the sort of psychoanalytic theory. In the 90s, I went back to modernism, to postmodernism and modernism, which I had been brought up in, but now I was reading the texts again and the theory to really firm, you know, sort of establish myself. And one of the things I realized is like, oh yeah, people like David Sally always knew that it's modernism stupid because their works were formally perfect. No matter what you thought about the equivalency of imagery in the work, you know, you have a woman's tit and then Mickey Mouse, but nevertheless, how it's arranged is always very smart and elegant. So it's modernism stupid. I love this the corner here, but this turns. And stupid, so modernism is very white and sort of typical red and white of October magazine's cover. And then stupid is very vulval and hairy and scraped. And I really liked the points at which the placement of the writing, which incidentally was the script writing that I learned how to write in a French lycée, so not block printing, so writing as drawing. I liked where, it was very important where something broke, because again, it was only my rule where it would break. So id ends up being an independent painting. And then the whole thing flows down a blood-tinted toilet. The next section is stealth bomber. When I had this slide re-scanned professionally, they very helpfully reversed it so they would read stealth because they thought I made a mistake in where I'd labeled the slide. I thought it was really funny. The whole idea is that it's stealth backwards. And just like I really like the corners, I also, one of the things that really has interested me about seeing the work now is the connectors. Because when I did it, I don't really remember whether, I would do a section, and then I would do another section. And I don't really remember whether I began to consider where one had how one had left off and where one began. I don't know, I don't think I did, and this is an indication for me of perhaps that I didn't, because this dark, it's actually stained linen canvas would indicate that it's, it's a new work. There's no, but I like these sort of connected, unconnected connectors between the works, kind of diagrammatic. So you have area of denial. That was a type of weapon that America had made, sold to Saddam Hussein. Then we were afraid they would use it against us. It was a type. It's a type of weapon. This is the way I understood it. I reread it this summer, and it's a little bit different than how it works. But essentially, it's a weapon that explodes above ground. So it denies the utility of the viability of the territory. It's about territory, not killing individual human being or animals around. And that goes down a blood-filled toilet, but it's an egg, so it's area denial egg. So the egg goes down the toilet, which is another experience that, in a sense, metaphorically, women experience. Another rake, which I like. And then I decided you have to go see the piece to see the end of it. But the very last words of Warfries are not appropriated. They're based on the previous section, which you'll see, which is appropriated from an advertisement for men's perfume. The essence of man, brute, men are back. And then, so I painted that, and I want you to go see it. And then I came up with sort of my ending, which is both not ironic and ironic, which is men are the essence of joy. I thought, well, actually, men are the essence of joy for me in short periods in my life. The true joy has come from them. But it ends, so there's first this like yellow joy, and then it goes like joy, joy, and the last one sort of like shit. An important canvas was the comma, And at first I thought, okay, now I know how I'm gonna punctuate these many pieces, but actually they just became individual punctuation marks. And that individual punctuation mark led to this painting, Slit of Flesh. I liked the semicolon the best as a punctuation mark because it divides two parts of a sentence. It doesn't announce a new part of the sentence. There's something about it. It's sort of like a pause, an intellectual pause. And it's also an asymmetrical form, so that makes it more interesting to work with. And so this painting basically imagined a gynecological examination where it would be discovered that language was in there, where the history of Western philosophy had placed the darkness of unreason. That became the cover of, a detail of it became the cover of Wet. And in terms of the dual practice, the first time, when this, I of course thought that a painting of mine had to be the image on the cover of my collected essays. And they were, nothing like that had ever happened to Duke University Press because they didn't have artists as authors until I came along. And so they had a meeting and whatever. And of course, it was an extremely popular cover. And then when I did the next book, no problem. So now we're going to switch gears to the work that is in the second part of my show. And it won't take too long. So I've been painting like that, the topsy-turvy painting theory and visual pleasure. I've been painting paintings where I was represented in the painting by a kind of non-gendered avatar that essentially was a philosopher reader, lived through vision glasses, and that was already surprising as a return of the figure. I never would have imagined that I would return to the figure in a way that it happened. But I was jolted and inspired and transformed by an exhibition at the Metropolitan about a year ago called Power and Majesty, the Congo, or the Congo Power and Majesty, that included work from the gigantic area that is the Congo, from the beginnings of contact with Europeans, which goes back to like the 1400s, to the early 20th century. And the very last room were these figures that are called power figures. That's the translation of a couple of different African words. And they were done at the point where colonization really began to destroy the fabric of the interior of the country. Up until then, you'd have Westerners coming to the ocean, area, or maybe up the river a little bit, and then you'd have African traders that would be the go-betweens. But once you got to the Belgians coming to get whatever the raw materials were, then they were just like in the country, and so the fabric of the country was essentially permanently destroyed, as far as I understand, till now. To a great degree, or in that several countries. And so they began to create these two-thirds life-size wooden figures that have all kinds of things in them. So they functioned as legal vouchers. So it's like, I say to you that I will not steal your cow, and then we nail and hammer a nail into this object, and that seals the deal. The magical part of it is under that conch shell is sacrificial material, whatever that means, but that's when you see African art, often it'll say, and sacrificial matter. So what the future, there are times where the Congolese would sell these or give them or have them sort of taken out of their hands to Westerners, and they would take out the conch shell, they would take out the sacrificial matter. So to them it no longer had power. But in some cases, if you take this into a battle and the Belgians have machine guns and you have a figure, it doesn't have power. And of course that's what interested me. These were overwhelmingly powerful, present figures, incredibly carved, just kind of like this. But they had no. They were about powerlessness at the same time. So, I went home. I felt I rarely get weepy when I'm in a museum, but I was so overcome by the show that I actually had to leave the gallery, and then I asked if I could come back through the back room so that I could go back into this room, and did some sketches. And the next day I went home and I thought, all right, I'm just gonna try something. So I cut out a piece of paper that was the size of these figures as far as I could determine. And I just drew, I just drew it kind of like, you know, leaning over it. And so you have a kind of a skull-headed figure and a little figure saying, are you a feminist artist? And that figure is just sort of creating a book or an artwork from the fluids coming from her body. And I had started just in the months before working with the image of the skull. I was influenced by a number of factors. A friend of mine had died of cancer, who's not that much older than me. And my former teacher, Amiram Shapiro, had died after a long, long decline. And I was overwhelmed with the sense of what her life had meant and what her legacy was and what it meant to be an ambitious woman artist and all of that. And the last factor was that there's been this fad in the art world in the last few years of validating very old women artists. I mean, like, as I say now, 100 is the new 70. So there's this weekend, a show is opening at the Whitney of a woman called Carmen Herrera. She was offered her show at the Whitney. She was probably 99. And they made her wait until this fall because they had to give Frank Stella a retrospective. And I burn with the unfairness of it, because there's another example is Etel Adnan, who's a painter and poet, who was suddenly her work appeared in a Whitney Biennial. I'd never heard of her. Certainly in the art world, as a painter, she was not that well known. And she's, you know, she's the hottest property. But she's in her 90s and she doesn't want to paint anymore. She's tired, you know. And Miss Herrera can't make her own art anymore. She has to have an assistant sort of execute her works. So women finally get this, you know, attention when it's just too late and it doesn't really matter. And it's nice if you live to be 101, good for you. Also, she's very, you have to have the money to hold on to your art and keep in relatively sane health so that you're not, as poor Miriam Shapiro would have been, you know, have dementia and not know whether it's happening to you or not. So as I did, you know, I started to do these figures. This was done the same day. And I did 4 in one day. And then I was sort of off to the races with these figures. And they fit very well into the economics of the moment, which is, when I'm teaching, I don't have time to paint. And oil paint is a place that I have to go to where I have to have constant access to it. It's the happiest place. There's something that happens in an oil painting that you know, gives me a sense of joy. But I can't do it when I have to do a million other things. And I don't like being interrupted. But I can do one of these in a day. I can do one of these in an hour. And that doesn't make them, I think, any less important. It just means that I can do them, and that's very important. So I did, starting November 19th of 15, I just began to do these maybe 3 a week, you know, on days where I was home. And one of the themes was, in fact, this idea of woman artists being trapped between the paradigm of still too young and not dead enough. And in the case of this one, I didn't like what was happening to the connector of the neck to the breast, so I whited them out. That left me with a kind of mask-like shape, which related to works that I'd done in the 70s, around the same time as Book of Pages. And these are rice paper, and some of those had text on them, in keeping with women being filled with language. I've enjoyed taking work pictures of these. So a lot of the remainder of the images that I'm going to show you, some of them are good quality photography, but others are ones that I've just taken because I take one at the end of every day, so I know when I did it. So you see all my tools, around on the floor.
So you actually paint these? They're horizontal.
I paint them on the floor or on a table. both. I finish them usually on table, but often I'm sort of standing over it. This one was a little bit different. There's an expression in Italian which I learned in the 70s. If you want to say that somebody's really tough, you say that they've got three balls. And the way I first heard it was an article about Lena Wertmüller, who was a very famous Italian director. So she was like so tough that she had three balls. So that was just in the back of my mind when I got a picture from the Heim Gross Foundation, from their archive, that they found this drawing, Christmas greeting, that I'd sent to the artist Heim Gross when I was 15. And I looked at it and I thought, wait, first of all, this is fantastic. I just love the way I drew it. And also, what was I doing? Why is this? I did not know that expression. I didn't even know the word ball when I was 12. I was one of the most sheltered people you could possibly imagine. So I thought, yeah, I'm going to just do this like exactly what I did when I was 15. And I did a number of works like that. And there's one little work like that in my show now. And that interaction between young Mira and old Mira takes place in a number of the works. So in this work, I appropriated my own work, which was a self-portrait I did when I was 19. It's a linoleum engraving, and where I'm drawing myself. And so here there's a kind of interaction, like the young Mira saying to the old Mira, so what happened? And the old Mira is, and there's another one similar to that, where the young Mira says, it'll never happen to me. And then the old Mira is like, yeah. In this drama of being the older woman artist, and when I said, you know, you have to be able to hold on to your work and keep it in good condition, you also have to believe in your work. So I believed in Warfreeze all the years nobody saw it. I was sitting at home one day and I thought, you know, it's like you hold, and a lot of my work is very fragile because it was done with rice paper, I just think. And a lot of my father's work is small and incredibly beautiful, but so tiny that there are times where the fragility just makes, and the responsibility makes me want to scream at its delicacy. And I thought, you know, you hold on to this like dear thing, for me anyway. And you try to believe in it. And this is a second iteration of the same work, using the fact that I'm working on tracing paper. And the work that I'm talking about is this dress book, which I have in my home in New York. It's never been shown. It's a very paradoxical thing, because it really bugs me that this work is not in the history of 70s feminist art. But it was done in 77, just as we were skating into that 1979 moment of transformation. And also, it's so fragile that it's terrifying to move it. Over the years, it's gotten a little more brittle. But the idea of it is that there's text on it. If you can read my handwriting, you can try to turn the pages of the woman and read the woman. Mm-hmm. So I did, in a 3-month period, I did about 30 of these works, which I called power figures. And I showed these in New York at Lyles and King Gallery, my first show in a new gallery on the Lower East Side in March. And it really worked like a frieze. I mean, it definitely, when you walked into the room, which was a little bit lower than the other space, you kind of walked in and then you walked around, and you were kind of face to face with these figures. Now, I had not anticipated going back into this type of work immediately, because I hadn't really absorbed doing it yet. And I was planning for my show here in LA to do a new sort of iteration of Warfreeze that would pick up on format but would have a different relation to language. I had some ideas, I thought they were interesting. I think it would have been interesting, but when it push came to shove, I couldn't get the materials. So plan B was to do another frieze. This is one of my iPhone pano shots of part of the installation. So the last image I'm gonna show you are mostly work images of working on the new group, which I then called Power Freeze too. But power is always in quotes. It's not just power, it has to be in quotes, scare quotes. So because I had a limited amount of time, I had a few rules. And one of them was that I had to do at least one a day so that we would have enough to choose from. And some days I did one, some days I did two or three, depending on what size. The other rule was, in order to do that, I had to suspend self-criticality. I have a very developed sense of criticality. Part of me is thinking of myself in relation to the art world and to contemporary art and blah, blah, blah. It's not a healthy, it is me, but I could not have that. I didn't have to like these or whatever, I just had to do them. The other thing is I thought it would be interesting to pursue the materiality of them further, to push them further towards sculpture, towards the feeling of those works that I had seen, the African works. And these are also a war freeze, but the war that they are, these are not really about the older women artists stuff. They are about the war against women. They are about Trump. They're about this horrible election. They're about many of the horrible things that happened this summer around the world. So here you see her wherever. I did this work in Provincetown, where I have a house. It's a very magical place where I have the privacy to work, but there's not a single wall, there's not a single room that is a traditional art studio. The upshot is that in order to produce a lot of work, and now that my mother has died, so she's not around to be horrified, I basically work everywhere. So I work on the living room, in the living room on the carpet, I work on the Persian carpets, and I work on the dining room table so you can see the salt and the Advil. as you can see, these figures are my height. The paper is actually, I tried to measure myself exactly, and then the figures are just, but they're life size basically. But most of them have a little figure between the legs that is connected to the larger figure by a thread of blood or umbilical cord, you can read it however metaphorically. And that little figure is often a tracing of the previous groups of work. I printed out images, I traced them, so they're small. And those are all like philosopher, reader, painter, and they're operating in this kind of shelter that is created between the legs of the more dramatically disturbed, larger figure. I also paint in the boiler room. That's my main studio, because the floor is too crowded. The Great Man Speaks is just something that I came up with. I'll tell you, I found this absolutely fascinating video of Jacques Lacan giving a talk. And it's a very famous one because somebody threw water on his notes, some sort of situationist guy. It was in the early 70s. But there's something absolutely, if you can see, the first time I saw it, I saw the whole tape, not just that little clip. And Lacan appears at a side door after this very elaborate introduction with the great man, and everybody's wearing like a three-piece suit, which is, very, very formal, except for the schlub, who's a situationist. And Lacan is wearing this indescribably, like a flowered shirt under some kind of sports jacket, and it's just the ego involved. So I did a drawing at the time called The Great Man Speaks, and meanwhile there's a woman like falling out the bottom of the little drawing. So that theme comes up in a lot of the drawings, The Great Man Speaks. Of course, it's completely ironic. And I also reprised from War Freeze the ear penis gun. to, you know, and some of the figures began to be grow boxing gloves. And this one, once I did the boxing gloves, there's this one that you can see. I thought, you know, there's that really funny picture of Judy Chicago where she's kind of like this. So I looked it up just to get exactly the right thing. And then Spin is from the Roger Ailes, Gretchen Carlson thing, where apparently at Fox News the execs would say to women, spin, so they could see their ass, you know, because that was how they were going to judge them, whether they were going to get a job or be promoted or whatever. So it's like, yeah. So this is on the kitchen table.
Oh,
and, you know, this was just like a horrible summer. I mean, every day that I did these, there had been some horrible, you know, act of violence around the world. And I want to go back to something just for a minute. So toxic. So one of the terms of that was discussed a lot this summer was the term of toxic masculinity, because every single one of the perpetrators, this is not an area where I see any parity for women, but were men. But also, many of them had histories of domestic violence. And so there was this whole thing that really these shootings were not so much, or shootings, bombings, mowings down, everything, you know, all over the world, were not only related to a specific politics, ISIS or whatever, but actually the individuals that perpetrated them were essentially these eruptions of toxic masculinity. So just to move along. Another rule of these works is that I don't hang them. I do them and then I lay one on top of the other because I don't really want to get to know them. I don't want to be influenced from day to day by them. I just want to move forward. So I had them stored on a bed upstairs, which makes it for some very funny studio visits because people would say, oh, I want to see the work that you're doing this summer. I think, oh, all right, we have to go up to my bed, you know, old bedroom. And then we like, you know, if it was a friend, it was okay. But if it was somebody I didn't know, it was like, okay, we're in a bedroom and I'm just like, you know, yeah. Turning, but it's functional. But oh, here it is. Sorry, you didn't see. I was looking at the picture, but now you see the bed. But usually in the middle of the summer, I lay out everything I've done up until that point, so I have a sense of what I've done, what I want to work on, where I'm going, you know, what I might go forward. So this is the work I've done between June 23rd and July 13th. And then the end of the show was done between then and August 11th. In addition to everything that I've shown you, and in addition to the African pieces that began this entire series, during the summer, two works came to mind. I didn't have the images up, but they were in my mind. And one is a great work of art, and the other is a work of my own. So this is this extraordinary Donatello sculpture of Mary Magdalene. It's wood. The penitent Mary Magdalene, and I don't think there's a representation of woman in history like this work, and there are other Mary Magdalenes, but she's both nearly a cadaver if you see close-ups of the carving. She's also young, and she's got, you know, muscles in her arms. She's represented in a way that is probably the most contemporary representation of something that was done such a long time ago, in you know, the late 1400s, I think, would be the date. So,
where is this?
This is in the Museo dell'Opera del Duomo. I think this piece was rediscovered during the flood of '66, from having been lost for centuries, and was restored. So I don't know whether it originally had color or gold on it or something. And then the other piece is a work that I did in 78-79 called Crazy Lady. And I'd moved back to New York from California and then Halifax. I was from New York. I was living downtown. So New York, you know, in 78 was still a pretty rough place. You saw the entrance to my door with the bomber in front of it. You know, it didn't have a lock on the door, the street door. There were a lot of crazy people in the street. I was buying my clothes. Everybody was buying our clothes from a place called Canal Jean, where, you know, just I don't know, a certain look, you know. So in a way, this was a very punk. Now I look at it and I think, oh yeah, that was like totally of its time. It was just like punk woman figure. But I didn't really like punk music. I didn't associate with that. The piece is, nothing is glued. It's all pinned together. I have no idea what, I do not believe that this work is still intact. It's been in storage since 95. I tried to protect it, but whether over the years, the weight of other works, however light, that's been put on it, I would be very surprised. But it was on my mind, and by being on my mind, it sort of moves me ahead to what I might do in the future. I'm not sure. And it, you know, again, it makes me think of my relationship to my own time period, my own cohort. And then I'll just show you a few last. This is one of my favorite of the pieces from the summer. It's towards the end. This is it on floor, just having been done. And this is it in the gallery. We just took a picture of it, just again, iPhone picture. The great man speaks, and then underneath, I think it says, her wherever.
Yeah.
Now you may recognize a certain image, and it's not your imagination.
Mm-hmm.
I did see the screen this at the beginning of the summer. It was shown in New York, and it is a totally absurd work, or it's completely impossible to have a normal reaction to it because it's so familiar. It's even worse than the Mona Lisa because it's so bizarre. Why is she screaming? But I had been already, I had done some figures, you know, holding their heads or hold. So I thought, you know, I'm going to go with it because, in fact, that is the way I feel. I have felt every day this summer. Like, I cannot stand it. You know, I am a complete like media junkie, but I have to turn off the radio constantly, the TV constantly, because if I hear African Americans, you know, whatever, everything that every word that comes out of that person's mouth. So the last few pieces of this, you know, that I did, I really just used that image. This is a close up. One of the things I was talking about with students last night was that it's really difficult to get at one of the most crucial parts of these figures, these drawings, which is their embodiment and the fragility and the relationship of you as a viewer to them. They're not framed currently. No matter how close I get, at least with the camera I'm using, which is not the greatest, I can't ever get that feeling. But anyway, so this is the modern screen. And this is the last one of the summer. And, you know, this is not, I'm not electioneering. But her. So I managed to pack that in. According to the clock, it's an hour and 8 minutes, which
is pretty damn good.
So I don't know how you guys would do, but if there's, I'm always very interested in questions and open.
Yeah, we do Q&A. Just let us know your energy level.
I'm fine.
But if we need to, we can go a half hour.
Yeah, well, let's just see where we go. But I feel like questions open up things that I couldn't remember to talk about or that are more interesting than what I said. So. You're welcome.
Can I just ask quickly about that work, Theory, Visual Pleasure?
Yeah.
Because you said when you were presenting it to us how you can't see both those things simultaneously, but you can in the work. Like, you see them, but you don't see them oriented the same way.
Right, you can see it topsy
right.
or turvy, but you
yeah.
can never, so either theory is on top or visual pleasure
but
is on top.
But I was curious about this simultaneity but reversibility at
mm-hmm.
the same time, and you referenced this a lot in the work, and I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more on this working method that you have where you're working off or against something that might have bled through or done on the back, like you're tracing. I mean, I just wanted to hear that as a kind of to connect those dots, because it seemed to come up a lot in the work, and it was interesting that that work was shown at the very beginning
right.
of the talk,
right.
and then it seemed to reverberate throughout a lot of different moments in the practice.
Well, I mean, I think that showing, I mean, the reason I showed my mother's moon is that I think it epitomizes something which, you know, I mean, I watched my parents work and it was, it made the work so interesting, but it was interesting no matter what you were looking at, and that the back was always considered. It's very, very rare that the back wasn't as interesting as the front. And I knew how they were made, so I knew that there was this aspect of instrumentality, but not aesthetic intentionality. And the same with my father. So for example, my father did all these amazing rings. Let's say I'm wearing a ring of my mother's. But in my father's case, you would take the ring, which was, you know, might have a girl flower on it, and then you take it off, and inside, in the part that no one would see, is a self-portrait engraved that's absolutely exquisite.
Yeah.
Why was he doing that? I don't know, but he did that. And that's what I saw as at age 5. Yeah. So I think that is the best, I think, most obvious reason why I have this inclination. And then the personal, temperamental, you know, sort of, it goes with an interest to be both. I mean, all the years that I was a painter, then I was a writer, and then I was a painter who was a writer. But you can't imagine how many people would say, would want me basically like a Sophie's Choice.
Yeah.
You know, which one are you?
Yeah.
You can't be both. And I would think, yeah, I actually can be both. Maybe you can't be both. But why is it, and I write about it in Web in the afterword, and I say, like, basically it's the same as people who are bilingual. Generally, people don't believe that one is fully bilingual. And I'm not fully bilingual. I learned French, I went to a French school, but English was definitely the dominant language. But I think that my sister was really bilingual, because English, actually French was her first language, but she lived in America, so then of course she spoke her, you know, she's American. And so I'm bi, some, whatever it is between the two parts of the brain. When I studied for the baccalaureate, not knowing actually about right, left brain function difference at that point in the 60s, or I just didn't know about it, I devised a way to study. We had like a study period where we weren't in school, which was just like a memorization period, you know, just like cramming for this major exam. And so I would study and memorize for half an hour or an hour, and then I would do a jigsaw puzzle for the same amount of time, which I didn't realize I was actually just using another part of my brain, and then I would be completely refreshed and I could go back to doing studies. So that all is part of this insistence on using both sides of my brain, basically. So, and that materializes itself through the formulation that my parents established of working on the back of everything, or the inside and the back.
That you're using, that you use for the series of Warfrees,
mm-hmm.
and also the series of Power, which I see in the Warfrees is like more thicker, it's maybe darker. While
you mean the paintings that went around the room?
Yes.
That's oil on stretched canvas,
mm-hmm.
on stretched linen. So it's completely different material than these paper pieces.
Could you explain like how you decide to use this topic, this content, this way of behaving with the material and the brush stroke, while in Warfrees it was different?
During the period where I did Warfrees, I was really focused more on oil painting, and I did a lot of drawings, but they were in sketchbooks. But I didn't do, that I recall right the second, sort of large drawings where the drawing was the major medium, because I'd come to oil and now oil was the major medium for me. So, but paper is a, and drawing is a deeply natural act for me. I once had a conversation with a friend of mine who, one of the artist's daughters who were artists, Mimi Gross, and we were both saying that we absolutely could not stand finger painting. Like whenever people say, oh, my daughter just did this little thing. And we both agreed that we never finger painted. We drew. You know, we drew with colored crayons maybe, but we were always drawing. And drawing also, I learned how to write in a French school, and learning how to write letters and script was taught in a way that made it much like drawing, which was that we were actually told, you know, you lift your hand up to make a light line, then you do a deep, you know, heavy line to go down. And I loved it. I loved it because I just love to draw. And so the decision is kind of instinctive. But also, as I said, right now doing the drawing suits the kind of the economy of my life. You know, so I could not do. There's no way that I could do. Even if I could do them in a day, there's no way I could do that many canvases because I can't afford that many stretch canvases. I have no place for them. All of those realities, it would be great, they'd have more value, but they wouldn't have the meaning of the fragile paper. So in a way, they have to be that.
So I was interested in kind of hearing you extend your kind of periodizations closer into the present. Because I was interested in the moment of the kind of 79 shift that you demarcate and then the move from meaning to privacy. Mm-hmm. But how do you track that within painting, or do you? Or do you see the one pressuring the other? Because one seemed like a narrative that was more internal to the history of painting, which obviously intersected with questions of media or culture or all kinds of other exogenous factors. But then the other was as much or more maybe about those other factors than it was about the history of painting from within, kind of pressure.
Okay, can you? I'm not quite sure what you're saying.
So I'm just kind of thinking about a move from painting being something, or an engagement with process or materials being sincere to something more ironic, or the post-picture show
mm-hmm.
moment, or how you were characterizing
right.
that.
So what's happening now?
Right. I mean, just because it seems like when you were talking about it before and after, later with the Occupy moment, it was about Occupy. It wasn't about something kind of within the history of institutionalized art making. And so I was wondering how you thought the one affected the other now, or
right.
kind of how you would characterize that.
Well, for one thing, I think I'll give an answer that's sort of at the extreme of
sure,
what I think. I don't give a fuck what's happening in art right now, because it's so much more important what's happening in Occupy
really?
Wall Street or anything else like it. And any art that's made that doesn't include that
mm-hmm.
is. I mean, I like beautiful art. I don't really, you know, not like certain things. But art that is synthetic in the sense of fake, or that synthesizes a range of ready-made options, which is even more, it's, in other words, appropriation now has morphed into something like zombie formalism, where, you know, you have one from column A and one from column B, and you don't really know where any of these things come from, which I've written about in Trite Tropes and stuff. You know, it's too late for me. I mean, in other words, I can't do that. And I you know, as you can see, I mean, there's the work is based on artworks. It's based on the news. It's based on my own body. And you know, as I said, this summer I had to suspend thinking about, like, what are younger women artists doing? What are, you know, what's hip right now? I mean, I do think that essentially appropriation still has won the day, that people still prefer to see something that they've already seen before.
Mm-hmm.
So it may have changed, you know, slightly. So zombie formalist paintings are abstract paintings that look, you know, they look like the others, but they were not achieved through the struggle of the others, and you feel that, you know, it's not that they're attractive, but what are they doing? I don't really care. But I do think, however, and this is where maybe Occupy as just one example of it comes through, and I feel it with, you know, some students, some younger artists, there is a desire for the real and a desire for authenticity and maybe a desire. I don't think people can really understand what privacy is at this point, but there maybe there's somewhere a longing for that, which I happen to have historical personal access to without really working at it.
I'm curious if either of your parents made art that wasn't like ritual Judaica, like did they all did?
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, for one thing, both of them made their living making exquisite, one-of-a-kind works of jewelry. My mother was less into, my father really came from a deeply Hasidic background in his youth, his childhood.
Mm-hmm.
But my mother was a modernist artist,
yeah.
You know, and she also did these amazing sort of bas-relief sculptures, and he did abstract sculptures. I curated a show of their work in 3 years ago, and I did not want to include any of their jewelry because the venue was did not have the kind of insurance that I would have liked. And I did not want it to be Judaica. Also, similarly, it would be hard to curate, to get the works. So it was all, it happened that there was all this abstract sculpture that they had done, but not at the same time. It was, my father died, and then my mother did all this work, and then she began to do these sculptures. So I called it abstract marriage, on the idea that sculptures of Russia and Ilya Shorty, on the idea that they he died, but the marriage continued, and then it continued in the form of this, like 40-year conversation with. You know, my mother to my father's work. So yes, they did do other things.
Mira?
I wore these today.
Oh, my mother's. Yeah, these are beautiful. These are,
I was gonna trade.
It's blue, my mother would say, this is blue, this is from Roman excavations, with a Polish accent. It's a bead made from crushed lapis lazuli. From Roman times with gold earrings. So these are her earrings.
Mm-hmm.
The workmanship.
I was going to trade you your ring for the earrings when
you
get to New York.
No way. My mother was a wonderful woman, but one part of our relationship was that her response to widowhood was not to get remarried, but to figure out what could she do to make a living? And she picked up my father's tools. She was a painter. And she began, and she really found her medium in how she was able to deal without much regular training, how she could deal with these materials. And the fulfillment that she got, and also I just love the work. So this ring was one of her earliest rings from 1964. And whenever she would show, she would show the jewelry, it was like the greatest show on earth.
Mm-hmm.
And every time she'd show this ring to some prospective buyer, I'd be like, finally she said, look, I'm never going to sell it. You're around like moaning and groaning, so here. And then this one she made, this is interesting. This ring she made for me in relation to the dress book, but many years later, but it was in her house, and she said, here's your shape that you do. So these are like I have other magnificent rings, but these are the basic rings. It's a unique, it's just a unique relationship to art making. As I said, it's not only that they were artists, it's the kind of artists they were that, it might have been better for me to have had a more conventional, from the point of view of my cohort that went to Cal Arts and whatever, if I'd been brought up in Omaha with not very interesting parents who you could leave the next day and never go see them again until you had to put them in the home, that would have been maybe better. I could have had an ironic relation to culture, but I really couldn't. Plus my parents were not in concentration camps, but they weren't survivors because that describes,
escaped.
They were refugees, they were war refugees. So it also inflected my relationship to America as some place I didn't think of as a joke or, I didn't feel cynical about it. I thought it was great.
So, there's a kind of haunting presence in a lot of the work that you were talking about today. And I'm thinking like someone like Toni Morrison might call this a kind of Africanist presence, right?
Mm-hmm.
A kind of haunting darkness that stands in the background. And I was thinking about this with Warfries, when you mentioned the Thomas Hill hearings, right? And you have a representation of the penis with the ear, which is black, right? And I think sort of quickly about Thomas's articulation of those hearings or characterization of them as a high-tech lynching,
mm-hmm.
right? And then the long history of castration during lynchings.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is this sort of invocation of the Congolese figure, right? With the paper pieces, and as you were mentioning, all of the things that were going on this summer. There's the gun figure,
mm-hmm.
right? And one can think of Philando Castillo or a figure like Rekia Boyd, right? Who's shot in the back of the head.
Mm-hmm.
By a cop. And it's not an explicit thing, but there seems to be a kind of presence of blackness that moves through a lot of this work. And I was just kind of wondering what that presence is for you, or if it's not even something that is sort of consciously there, but appears at various places.
I think that the appearance of any kind of a pigment or color in Warfries is an aesthetic decision. I mean, in other words, it was the language that determined what it, the piece, and the rest was more aesthetic decisions. When I first started the Power Frieze, I mean the power figures last year, I was reluctant to. I didn't want to claim the I'm not claiming that I'm doing work like the African figures. However, I was, dynamized by them, and then I left out the fact that also there was an incredible show of Picasso sculpture at MoMA, which had just, I had both catalogs, and the whatever one says about Picasso, the guy would just do anything to do an artwork. I mean, he would just, one of the most exciting works looked like he had taken like a paper bag and just cast it. So it's just like this lump of plaster, and it was just like endlessly interesting. And so both the two catalogs, Congo and Picasso, they gave me courage. This summer, I didn't show one figure just because I don't have a good image of it. It was one of the ones that was lying on the bed. That I can't remember what had happened the day that I did it. It was one of those awful days, like it might have been Baton Rouge after Dallas or something, where you just thought, what else can happen? And of course, it's involved with racial politics in America. So. But the fact is, I also use brown a lot in my work, always. Raw umber is like my default color, and I don't think that has anything to do with race, I just happen to like it. It's the color of wood, which in our house there's a lot of, it was one of the first sort of materials that I saw, and I live with those antique wood. So, but I mean, definitely this summer, there was no way of not relating racial politics, as well as other politics, to what I was doing. Yeah, definitely. Maybe we should break, unless there's, yeah.
Yeah,
no,
I just want to ask one more question.
Yeah.
It's kind of a two-part thing, like scale and oil paint, like do you see yourself doing large oil paintings ever? And the second part of that is, do you imagine there's a place for that kind of super, super kind of material evocation of the bodily that you were doing in the early 90s? Like the, the semicolon piece.
Right. Because there's this sort of unfurling of the work, there's no way of knowing that I wouldn't go back to it. Even just seeing Warfries,
mm-hmm.
may have an influence,
mm-hmm.
I have done a few of these figures as oil paintings,
mm-hmm.
at the same size.
Mm-hmm.
So the not the tallest, but
that's interesting.
And they're very expressionistically painted because they're also painted very fast to some extent. One of them is pretty successful. The other one I was working too fast. So I feel like the window is closing a little bit in terms of physical ability. I mean, I'm very haunted by a number of artists who were my friends, like Leon Golub and still living Ida Applebrook, who in their in their sixties did, or in Leon's case earlier, did very large works, and in their seventies began to develop, you know, physical conditions that made it harder and harder to do certain kinds of work.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm torn between a sense that I'd like to have a shot at it, you know, and that the window may be closing, and at the same time, is it really necessary? But I think it would be, I mean, financially I can't afford to do it. You can't just do one 20-foot painting.
Sure you
yeah.
can.
My apartment is actually, now I live someplace where it's harder to do. But I mean, you know, let's say that for me, one of the greatest, you know, I mean, I haven't seen it for a long time, but Colbiz, the studio, the painter, you know, it used to be in a room in the Louvre. Now they moved it to the Quai d'Orsay. They might as well just have thrown it out the window. But when it was in, there was a room at the Louvre which had the funeral at Ornans, the studio of the painter, Raft of the Medusa, and Delacroix's The Death of Sardanapalus.
Mm-hmm.
All these huge paintings. It was like the culmination of the history of Western art and the great tradition of painting. And when you see those, you think, yeah, I'd kind of like to try that. and especially, I like Colbiz, the physicality of his painting a lot. But we'll see, you know. So it's not in my mind, that's what I would say.
Yeah.
And one possible avenue is to do it through paper and sort of see whether I can build formally, compositionally, a large space, you know, that would be interesting and would. So I don't know about Warfries or in other words, that was big, but in a different way. But we're talking about like one service.
Yeah.
I did not believe in it for myself earlier in my life. I thought it was around the time I was doing Warfries. I would have thought it was completely ridiculous to have a giant penis, you know, floating and whatever I was doing at that time. There were some larger works that have not been seen. They are multiple canvas in a different way. I did a lot of work during that.
I think that's awesome.
There's one that goes around where. It's like a board game that goes around, and so the language goes from sexualized body part to body part, and the modules are bigger, and it creates a fairly large thing. But that's different than, there's two or three major multi-canvas paintings that create one image. They're on my website. One of them is called Dix, or The Impregnation of the Universe, and I would like to show those works. They've never been shown. They never was seen. Actually, that painting, which I thought was, you know, when I did it, I was very excited. But then it was never seen by anybody. I did it like on a summer, you know, afternoon. I mean, no, it took me longer. But once I did it, and then life moved on, and it's never been seen. So those were. And I still think that there's something interesting about the way in which the line between the canvases creates a complexity of reading and interrupts the reading. So in fact, philosophically, I'm still not sure I really believe in the unified canvas. That's of a large unified canvas. There may be something more deeply rooted in me that wants to keep it fragmented in that very specific way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.